Well, thank you very much for joining us today. I have the privilege of serving as the chair of a panel composed of internationally renowned scholars, advocates, and activists on the front lines of complex issues at the intersection of freedom of expression, national security, and religious freedom. I want to begin first by thanking Columbia University, President Bollinger, and the organizers of this important conference, including Dr. Agnes Calamar, Dr. Hallie Johnson, and the wonderful staff at the Global Freedom of Expression and Information. So admittedly, this topic is particularly dear to my heart and one that I struggle with on a daily basis as a scholar, an Egyptian American, and a Muslim. As a scholar of authoritarian regimes in the Middle East, I am keenly aware of the repression that arises from restrictions on freedom of expression. I have colleagues in Egypt who are currently serving jail time for nonviolent protests calling for accountability against corruption, torture, and military trials of civilians. And laws restricting speech, expression, and association are often used to justify the targeting of political opposition and civil society as a means of preserving the authoritarian regime's firm and indefinite grip on power. In turn, the politically repressive environment contributes more towards more violence, both by the state against its citizens and by non-state terrorist groups against civilians and the state. Hence, less free speech can indeed lead to less security. But yet, as an ethnic and religious minority in the United States, I also feel the harsh sting of stigmatization produced by hateful and racist speech spewed by American presidential candidates, mass media pundits, and state officials who portray all Muslims as inherently violent and unworthy of living in the United States. And as an American civil rights scholar, I have documented the troubling rise of the violations of Muslim civil rights in employment, schools, and public spaces. Muslims are becoming the scapegoats of a rising xenophobic nativism on full display in our presidential elections. And as a Muslim woman, I have friends who have removed their headscarves, not out of free choice, but out of fear of being attacked in public or in their own homes. And as a mother, I fear for my own children's safety and psychological well-being as they are bombarded with news coverage of Muslims only as terrorists, not as doctors, lawyers, professionals, and thought leaders, which then infects their school environments as their peers bring with them stereotypes they learn at home. So as we consider these difficult issues and these tensions that have no easy answers, I'd like to proffer three themes to frame our discussions today. The first is that context matters. While a purist free speech approach may be beneficial in a particular context, it may produce a net harm in another. No law operates in a vacuum or separate from a multitude of societal norms that shape a law's impact on a people in that particular context. Second, power matters. Not every target of hateful, offensive, or outright racist speech has the same access to the media, government officials, and the courts to shield themselves from the dignitary and civil rights harms. Hence, the marketplace of ideas may not be as free and open to everyone as the law presumes. And third, freedom is subjective. One person's freedom to speak may infringe on another person's freedom to practice her religion. Similarly, one person's religious beliefs may infringe on another's freedom to express herself. As global migration increases and societies become more multicultural, preserving the various freedoms that collectively produce an open and thriving society will require more thoughtful laws and policies. Now, thankfully, we have some of the most esteemed scholars and advocates on the panel to address these complicated issues at the intersection of freedom of religion, freedom of expression, and national security. And I will now introduce them in the order of their presentations. They will each give a 10-minute presentation, after which will be followed by a question and answer from the audience. So first, we will have via Skype, Sheikh Maytham. We switched the order a bit. I don't have my phone. Oh, sorry. Okay. We have Sheikh Maytham Al Salman. Sheikh Maytham Al Salman is a Shia cleric from Bahrain, an internationally respected interfaith leader, and a renowned thought leader. He advocates for peaceful coexistence and mutual respect between cultures, religions, and sects. Sheikh Maytham Al Salman is the founding member and current coordinator of the Middle East and North Africa Civil Society Coalition to Counter Incitement to Hatred, a multi-stakeholder platform established in 2015 that is dedicated to ending incitement to violence. In 2011, Sheikh Maytham, in punishment for his advocacy, was arrested, detained for several months, and tortured, as were members of other human rights defenders, as a number of other human rights defenders, some of whom are still in prison. And in fact, he is subject to a travel ban right now, which is why he unfortunately cannot join us live. Next, we will have Steve Killelea. He is an accomplished entrepreneur in high technology business development and at the forefront of philanthropic activities focused on sustainable development and peace. In 2007, Steve founded the Institute for Economics and Peace, an international think tank dedicated to building a greater understanding of the interconnection between business, peace, economics, with particular emphasis on the economic benefits of peace. And IEP's groundbreaking research includes the Global Peace Index, the world's leading measure of peacefulness. And in 2013, Steve was nominated one of the top 100 most influential people in armed violence reduction by the UK group Action on Armed Conflict. Next, we will have Jacob Mchangama. Jacob is the director of Justitia, and in addition to his law degree, he has a master's degree in human rights and democratization from the European Inter-University Center. In 2007, Jacob obtained his license to practice law at Plesner, where he worked in the Division of Corporate Finance, specializing in mergers and acquisitions and private equity. And since 2005, he has taught international human rights at the University of Copenhagen. Then we will have Suzanne Nossel, she was named executive director of the Penn American Center in 2013. Prior to Penn, she served as executive director of Amnesty International USA. Her work led to the passage of the Afghan Women and Girls Security and Promotion Act in 2012, which drew attention to the chilling climate for free expression in Russia through the case of imprisoned punk band Pussy Riot. She is the author of Presumed Equal, What America's Top Women Lawyers Really Think About Their Firms, and Suzanne contributes to and comments on human rights issues for news outlets, including CNN and NPR. Then we will have Professor Stephen Vladeck, who is a professor of law at American University, Washington College of Law. His teaching and research focuses on federal jurisdiction, constitutional law, and national security law. A nationally recognized expert on the role of the federal courts in the war on terrorism, Professor Vladeck's prolific and widely cited scholarship has appeared in an array of legal publications, including the Harvard Law Review and the Yale Law Journal. And finally, but certainly not least, we have Chinmayi Arun, who is a research director of the Center for Communication Governance at the National Law University, Delhi, where she is also an assistant professor of law. She is a member of the Indian government's multi-stakeholder advisory group for the India Internet Governance Forum and one of the academic experts for the Internet Jurisdiction Projects Observatory. She has published numerous academic articles on surveillance and the right to privacy in India. So as you can see, we are very fortunate to have a broad array of expertise from all over the world.
Okay, right. I'm just wondering, is this mic system working? Can you hear me up the back or not? It's sounding awfully dull when you're sitting on the table. So the Institute for Economics and Peace, one of the projects which we produce is the Global Terrorism Index. It's probably considered the landmark study on terrorism used by most counterintelligence, counterterrorism groups around the world, including NATO and many, many others. And it's regularly cited in the media. So what I'm going to do is just go through some of the results of that just to give some feel and flavour of the background in terrorism, just the scale and the size of it, and just some of the socioeconomic factors which are associated with it as well. So 2014, 32,000 people died through terrorist incidences. This is 80% higher than the prior year, 2013. Half those 32,000 deaths were private citizens. Now, although terrorism increased by the staggering 80%, the deaths of private citizens increased by 172%. Like these figures I'm going to give you now are staggering. Five countries account for 78% of the deaths in terrorism. They're Afghanistan, Pakistan, Syria, Iraq, and Nigeria. Now, if we now look at the terrorist groups, five terrorist groups account for 74% of all attacks. They are ISIL, Boko Haram, Al-Qaeda, Taliban, and the Fulani, which are a tribal group of 20 million people in Nigeria. Now, if we take four of those groups, ISIL, Boko Haram, Al-Qaeda, and Taliban, they all share a common identity and philosophy, and they are all followers of some form of Wahhabism, of which we can say Wahhabism is the state religion for Saudi Arabia. Much of this has come about through the supports of Salafist schools over the last 30 to 40 years, which are mainly funded out of Saudi Arabia. If we look at the number of countries which have suffered greater than 500 deaths, 2014, that number jumped from five countries to a staggering 11 countries. So that's 120% higher than what it was 1 year before. So not only are we seeing the intensity of terrorism increasing, we're also seeing the breadth of it expand. The 162 countries we covered, about half of them had terrorist attacks and resulting in deaths in 2014. So now if we went back to 2001, what we've got is about a 900% increase in deaths from terrorism. So to put that in perspective, that's 140,000 people have died in the 15 years from terrorist attacks. But something here which we really should put into perspective, and I think this perspective is incredibly important, is if we look at the number of people who died by homicides in 2014, so it was 16 times more than the number of people who died from terrorism. Now, that poses a very fundamental question. Why is there so much emphasis on terrorism when we've got other forms of death which are so much stronger? And I think that's an existential issue for society. And for my thinking, is where you get the death of an individual, that's not an attack on the social system itself, whereas terrorism's an attack on the political identity and culture of a system. Therefore, the whole system, which is the nation state, responds very vigorously. If we start to now look at the breakup of people who die in terrorist attacks, 99.4%, like this is staggering, 99.4% die in countries which have either got an ongoing conflict or have got high levels of state-sponsored terror. By state-sponsored terror, I mean extrajudicial killings, torture, imprisonment without trial. And that brings us back to our foreign policy and wars we start, which we can't complete, and the supporting of certain types of regimes which sponsor state-sponsored terror. Now, the inverse of this, and if we look in the West, only 0.5% of terrorist attacks have occurred in the West. Now, when we look at the social economic conditions surrounding them, it comes back to the same things which are associated with high levels of violence or high levels of, let's say, drug taking and other antisocial behaviour. If we went to France, we went to Moulinville, what we'll find that there's a high level of discrimination against the Muslims in those societies. As I say this, I find this really hard actually to actually comprehend myself, and each time I say it, I feel the same. If we went to France, 8 to 9% of the population's Muslim. You went into the jails, 70% of the people in jails are Muslim. Now, if we start to look at foreign fighters, what we find is France has got the highest number out of the West, about 1,200. Belgium has 460, but on a per capita basis, it has the highest number of terrorists. Foreign fighters going to fight in Syria. Lone wolf attacks count for 70% of the attacks in the West since 2006. But if we look into these, what we find within the West, the motivations of the attacks, 68% are actually political and only 20% of them are Islamic. I'll just go for one more minute. Now, we did some work on how terrorist groups actually stop. We based that on a study done from RAND. They studied about 260 terrorist groups over a period of about 40 years. 6% were stopped militarily. 13% achieved their aims, and the other 80% ceased through a combination of policing and political negotiation. However, once you got more than 1,000 fighters in a terrorist group, they were never stopped without a military intervention. At that point, I think I'll stop.
Thank you. Jacob,
there next. Video or?
Oh, would you like to do the video? Oh, okay.
President Ballinger, respected chair, and speakers, ladies and gentlemen, it's a true honor for me to join you at the Columbia University 2016 Justice for Free Expression Conference through video. Although I have confirmed and planned well ahead to attend the event in person, however, it's unfortunate that I'm deprived by authorities from the right to travel by intentionally delaying the issuance of my passport since January. Where does freedom of expression stand today in Bahrain? Has it improved or worsened since 2011? Before highlighting the current situation, I would like to state that freedom of expression in Bahrain has traditionally been under censorship and restrictions for decades. However, things have slightly improved after the current ruler, King Hamad bin Isa Al Khalifa, has been announced as the King of Bahrain in 2002. However, the government maintained a strict monopoly on broadcast media in the period between 2002 and 2011. Private broadcasting licenses were not granted. Only one of the six daily newspapers, Al Wasat, was and still is considered truly independent of government influence, although it had to practice a high level of self-control and self-censorship in order to avoid closure and prosecution. During the years between 2002 and 2011, human rights organizations like Amnesty International and Human Rights Watch reported ongoing violations and restrictions imposed on freedom of expression. In 2011, Bahrainis were influenced by the Arab Spring and by the events in Egypt and Tunisia. Thousands of Bahrainis marched to the streets on the 14th of February 2011 and chose the Pearl Roundabout as a sit-in. The overall human rights situation collapsed when authorities announced the emergency law in March 2011. Tens were killed, thousands were arrested and sacked from their jobs, mosques were demolished, and systematic human rights violations prevailed. According to human rights organizations, the majority of those imprisoned during martial laws were prisoners of conscience. The state of emergency was soon lifted in June 2011 after serious denouncements from the international community and human rights organizations around the world and calls for reforming the human rights situation in Bahrain. Soon after that, in fact, in June 2011, the king ordered the establishment of an independent commission of inquiry to investigate the events that took place in February and March. The commission was chaired by Professor Mahmoud Sharif Bassiouni. The report of the Bahrain Independent Commission of Inquiry was submitted to the king on the 23rd of November 2011. The report has revealed that the majority of arrests and charges involved the exercise of freedom of opinion and expression that are guaranteed by the Bahraini Constitution and by the ICCPR. The report has also revealed that a large number of individuals, including myself, were prosecuted before the National Safety Courts and imprisoned for violating Articles 165, 168 of the Bahraini Penal Code. These laws, according to the report, especially Article 165 of the Criminal Penal Code, that states that a person shall be placed, or a prison sentence shall be passed against any person who incites others to develop hatred or hostility towards the system of government. This law does not meet with international human rights laws and the Constitution of Bahrain in accordance with the report. The report also has revealed the immediate need to reform laws and practices in order to comply with Article 19 of the ICCPR. Furthermore, the report has clearly recommended authorities to review all convictions of persons who have been charged with offenses involving political expression and not consisting of any advocacy of violence or incitement to violence. The report has called to drop outstanding charges against prisoners who have expressed their political opinions through peaceful means. It has also recommended relaxing censorship and media and allowing the opposition greater access to the media, including TV. It has called to undertake appropriate measures, including legislative and non-legislative measures, to prevent the incitement of violence, hatred, sectarianism, and other forms of incitement that could potentially lead to the violation of international human rights. Bahrain had a golden opportunity after the report was presented to adapt human rights and political reforms that could potentially pave the way towards dialogue and reconciliation. Since Professor Bassiouni is one of the reputable speakers at this conference, I would like to express my gratitude for his never-to-be-forgotten sincere efforts to reveal some of the realities of the human rights situation in Bahrain. And I would like to state, if his recommendations have been implemented, Bahrain would have been miles closer towards reconciliation. Professor Sharif Bassiouni deserves a big thank you from the people of Bahrain. Thank you. Where do we stand today? More than 4 years after the historical reports, the report. Today, in 2015, hundreds of peaceful activists who publicly expressed their views are still being charged under Article 165 of the Bahrain Penal Code with the incitement of hatred against the system of government. Instead of implementing the Bassuni recommendations and modifying laws that did not comply with Article 19 of the ICCPR, new laws have been imposed to further restrict the right of freedom of expression. In 2014, there was a new law which amended the penal code and provided for up to 7 years in prison and a fine for insulting the authorities and national symbols. It is also a crime right now in Bahrain to offend the government, the National Assembly, the army, courts, judges, public institutions, governmental agencies, or to advocate any form of change in the system of government. These provisions are widely instrumented to censor human rights defenders, raising awareness about the current abuses. The arrests, trials, and harassments in 2015 and 2016 demonstrate that the Bahraini authorities are increasingly intolerant of being criticized and are determined to continue repressing the peaceful exercise of the right to freedom of expression. One of the charges brought against Sheikh Ali Salman, the general secretary of the biggest political party in Bahrain, was offending public institutions. Even though offending governmental bodies in international law is not sufficient enough to justify penalties. Furthermore, the tendency has multiplied to use Article 309 of the Bahrain Penal Code that states that punishment for a period of 1 year and a fine shall be imposed upon any person who commits an offense by any method of expression which is regarded as an insult against religious symbols. Blasphemy and defamation laws are being utilized to further restrict freedom of expression. And this is an open door to abuse, especially in countries which witness unfortunate sectarian divides. I was recently charged with defaming religious symbols. Although the charges were baseless, however, the charge is a clear example of the dangers embedded in blasphemy laws in Bahrain. And in political environments where there is unrest, it's very clear that these laws can be used to punish reformists calling for democracy and respect of international human rights. Further restrictions could be imposed in 2016 by a new anti-hate law that might be approved soon. I believe that the new anti-hatred law is a blasphemy law in disguise. The new anti-hatred law could further restrict freedom of expression rather than safeguard the society from the incitement of hatred. We all know blasphemy laws in non-democratic countries are very selective and are applied in a discriminatory manner. they could eventually be instrumented as a punishment tool to deal with outspoken voices. In general, further restrictions and censorship have been imposed on freedom of expression since 2011, and the government has unfortunately failed in implementing the Bahrain Independent Commission inquiry recommendations related to freedom of expression. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. Thank you.
We will now move on to Jacob.
Can I have that click for the PowerPoint? Thank you. It's a real honor to be part of this distinguished panel, this conference. So thank you very much to the organizers for inviting me. I'd like to ask the question of whether Europe is moving towards harmonizing a model of militant rather than liberal democracy when it comes to freedom of expression. I don't have a clear answer to my own question. It would require more research, but I'll focus on developments in Scandinavia and the UK, as well as look at a bit at EU and Council of Europe bodies. We all know that freedom of expression is unevenly protected among Europe's democracies. Simplistically, we can distinguish between liberal and militant democracies, Germany being the classic example of a militant democracy with a constitution limiting individuals and parties whose ideas are opposed to the constitutional order and values. So various communist, national socialist, and Islamist parties and associations are or have been banned. Currently, there are 15 Islamist groups in Germany that are banned. France may not be termed a classical militant democracy, but it too has chosen to ban Holocaust denial, close mosques, aggressively enforce laws against hate speech and glorification of terrorism. And I think that the current state of emergency shows that France's democratic model is not one for sitting on its hands when it's challenged by extremism. Then on the other hand, you have the Scandinavian countries and the UK that have traditionally been somewhat more tolerant of intolerance, though of course also with exceptions. But it would seem that this more permissive model is caught between the rock of terrorism and the hard place of racism and intolerance, edging some of these states towards a model of militancy rather than liberalism. I'll start with the UK. Here's a quote from David Hume. And we can discuss whether this quote is still an accurate description of the state of freedom of expression in the UK. Britain's model of accommodating an increasingly multicultural population has to some extent been premised on the idea that social peace requires restrictions of certain expressions that are grossly offensive or hateful to members of particular groups. So this was the basis of the controversial Religious Hatred Act of 2006. And this logic has, for instance, seen an atheist sentenced to 6 months suspended prison for leaving religious caricatures of Jesus, Pope, and Muhammad in a prayer room in an airport in John Lennon Airport, of all places. After the recent attack in Brussels, this person posted this tweet, and that might be quite insensitive and not very well thought out, but it actually led to Scotland Yard in arresting him for inciting racial hatred, which seems a rather draconian move, at least from my perspective. Here is another tweet from the police in Greater Glasgow. It's from April 1st, but it was not an April Fool. It has since been removed because, as you can imagine, the police were brutally trolled by responders on Twitter. So, but I think this says a lot when you have the police warning people about insensitive, hurtful tweets in a liberal democracy. And it's not the first time that the police in Scotland have done this. When it comes to terrorism, the UK is also taking drastic measures. So in 2012, a Muslim woman was sentenced to 1 year in prison for downloading two issues of the Al-Qaeda publication Inspire on her mobile phone. Now, she was found guilty of, quote, possessing information likely to be useful to someone committing or preparing an act of terrorism, though the sentencing judge agreed that she had no actual involvement in terrorism herself. Now, the current government has tried to enact a counter-extremism bill, and it has tried to define extremism as, quote, the vocal or active opposition to our fundamental values, including democracy, the rule of law, individual liberty, and the mutual respect and tolerance of different faiths and beliefs. The bill, I'm not sure at what stage it is at the moment, but not long ago, it included measures such as allowing the Home Secretary to ban extremist groups, allowing law enforcement to stop individuals engaging in extremist behavior, new powers to close down premises used to support extremism, and new measures to allow Ofcoms to stop broadcasting of extremist contents. So in other words, it would seem that the UK seems to be moving towards imposing different levels of censorship. I mean, I don't think there's any other way to put it. So let me move to Scandinavia now, and traditionally liberal Denmark, which is my home country, even though it says the US here, we're not yet the 51st state. So yet, Bernie Sanders might have ideas. He seems to be very keen on Denmark. Most of you will probably know there was a terrorist attack against a free speech debate on blasphemy in Denmark in February 2015. And shortly after this attack, the government had to decide whether it would repeal Denmark's blasphemy law. It decided not to, and it decided the need to prevent the burning of holy books and to prevent violent reactions from domestic and foreign groups. So in other ways, they accommodated what we could call the assassin's veto in Denmark. There are also signs that Danish police and courts have expanded Denmark's hate speech ban to now include harsh criticism of religion, maybe a bit along the lines of what we heard in Bahrain. So blasphemy is covered by Article 140 of the Danish Penal Code, which punishes anyone who publicly ridicules or insults the dogmas or worship of any lawfully existing religious community in this country. No one has been charged since 71, no one has been convicted since 46. So the blasphemy ban remains dormant, but Denmark's ban on hate speech is actively in force. And where the blasphemy ban protects religious dogmas, the hate speech ban protects certain groups, including adherents of religion, from degrading or insulting expressions. And so in December 2015, there was a man who on Facebook uploaded a clip of himself burning the Quran. And he has been preliminarily charged with hate speech. Now, interestingly, in 1997, there was a Danish artist who burned a Bible on news, on Danish taxpayer-funded broadcasting channel news. And our chief prosecutor decided not to charge this person either with blasphemy, and he didn't even mention the possibility of hate speech. So this decision to charge the Quran burner seems to indicate not only a lower protection for freedom of expression in general, but also an expansion of hate speech to cover what has previously been understood to constitute blasphemy. So this example of what we might call scope creep seems to have been confirmed in another decision. It's admittedly only a first instance decision by the District Court of Elsinore, which of course is the setting of Hamlet. So you might say that something is rotten in Denmark. I'll let you decide when I've talked more about the case. Here, a man was convicted for hate speech in February 2016. Again, we're talking about comments on social media. He had on Facebook compared, quote, the ideology of Islam with Nazism, and he had also said that Islamists, not Muslims, Islamists constituted a threat. And so the court in Elsinore found that these statements about the ideology of Islam pertain to Islam generally, and that they constituted generalizing claims that are insulting and degrading towards the adherents of Islam. Again, my interpretation is that equating degrading and insulting comments aimed at Islam with anti-Muslim hate speech, the court has actually expanded the Danish hate speech ban to cover blasphemy, much like the OIC has been trying to do under Article 20 ICCPRs ever since Resolution 1618 during the Istanbul process, as some of you might be familiar with. When it comes to terrorism, recent developments also show that there are limits to liberalism in Denmark. In 2015, an Islamist was convicted to 4 years in prison and revocation of his citizenship for furthering, inciting, and glorifying terrorism for a number of comments on Facebook. One of them was a photo of World Trade Center in flames and a manipulated 7-Eleven logo reading 9-11 made by Qaeda. There were also some Quranic verses. These comments were found to constitute both furthering and glorification of terrorism. So basically, the Danish courts did not really distinguish between various statements. Some of them were clearer than others. And only last week, the Danish government announced that it will seek to stop so-called foreign hate preachers from entering the country. And even more draconianly, it will seek to criminalize expressions that undermine Danish laws and Danish society, whatever that means. I'll try to contrast Denmark, I have very little time, with Norway, because in Norway has taken a different approach. In 2015, Norway fast-tracked the abolishment of its blasphemy law as a result of the attack against Charlie Hebdo. It has also had a very similar case to the Danish case on incitement and glorification of terrorism, where the Norwegian courts determined that glorification of already committed acts are not punishable. And then it looked at these comments on Facebook, saying that incitement requires a degree of concretization to be met, and basically said that incitement had to meet a really high threshold, and so they acquitted the defendant. Very, very briefly, the limits on free speech in Europe are obviously ultimately determined by the European Convention on Human Rights. EU law also plays a role and has supremacy over national laws. And on national security, both the draft EU directive on combating terrorism and the Council of Europe Convention on the Prevention of Terrorism include glorification of terrorism as permissible grounds for limiting freedom of expression. In a number of cases, the European Court of Human Rights has confirmed that glorification may be restricted, setting the threshold lower than incitement, though in other cases, many of the Turkish cases, the European Court of Human Rights have said that that restricting comments on terrorism have gone too far. When it comes to religion and hate speech, of course, the European Court of Human Rights has allowed, in some cases, blasphemy bans and excludes hate speech, including against religious groups, often from the protection of freedom of expression as such as an abuse of rights under Article 17. Now, at the level of the EU, there's a framework decision on combating racism and xenophobia, which obliges EU states to criminalize hate speech. And lately, the Commission has signaled that it wants to see the framework decision enforced more vigorously. So Commissioner for Justice and Home Affairs, Vera Jourova, said in a speech in October 2015 that member states must firmly and immediately investigate and prosecute racist hatred, and she found it disgraceful that Holocaust denial is a criminal offense in only 13 member states. Finally, she also opened up for the prospect that the EU Commission might start bringing infringement procedures against member states that do not enforce hate speech law. So we could see the specter of the Commission suing member states for having too high a threshold of freedom of expression. That would be a mouthwatering prospect for Erdogan, for Putin, for Lukashenko, and others. Thank you very much.
Suzanne?
Great. Well, that's a good introduction for me, and thanks very much for having me and for moderating Sahar. I wanted to frame my remarks around the idea that the ground for what I think of as unpalatable or borderline or ugly speech is shrinking. And I'll start with just a quick reminder of an anecdote that you're probably all familiar with. At PEN America, the organization that I run, just about a year ago, we gave a Free Expression Courage Award to the surviving staff of Charlie Hebdo. And we were to present that award at our big annual gala. And about 10 days before the gala, six writers pulled out of the event on the grounds that they thought Charlie Hebdo was racist and they didn't like the idea of giving them an award. And a big international firestorm ensued. There was heavy media coverage. Within the space of those 10 days, there were over 300 published pieces and millions of tweets and blog posts and Facebook posts, and it's now sort of the one-year anniversary, and we're seeing anniversary publications and commentary coming out. And social media definitely drove the intensity of that international discussion. It felt like being in the middle of a vortex for those 10 days. And amidst it all, there was the incident in Garland, Texas, where two would-be jihadists were killed when trying to attack a Let's Draw Muhammad contest that Pamela Geller had put on. And so we, in that situation, argued a number of things. We argued that without the likes of Charlie Hebdo, it would be only people like Pamela Geller who staked out and defended this terrain of being willing to draw Muhammad, and that we would cede that terrain to people with truly an agenda of hate if we didn't come out and defend Charlie Hebdo and that staff for continuing in their efforts despite threats against them. And we talked about it as defending the outer precincts of free speech, the place where few want to tread because it is offensive and incendiary. If it doesn't get you killed, it'll get you reviled and pilloried and ostracized. It's so easy to be accused of racism or xenophobia or religious intolerance. And so we pressed forward, and when we presented the award, Dominique Sopo, who's the head of SOS Racism, France's largest anti-racism organization, decided to come to New York on his own dime and be part of the presentation of the award, and gave a kind of fiery speech saying that those who protested the award were it was as if they were killing the Charlie Hebdo staffers again. And so it was kind of a rousing defense for unpalatable speech that night, but I think the victory was ephemeral. And I see that in a number of respects. And I think it's for a number of different reasons. I mean, I think Sahar put it very well in her introduction. It feels like the ground has shifted. And some forms of offensive speech have come into the political mainstream here in this country in ways that I think few of us expected. A lot of the people who supported our decision, you know, quietly, you know, and they still do, they kind of quietly question it. Why would you defend that? They want to relitigate it. You know, at the same time, the cartoonists at Charlie Hebdo have sort of each, you know, and perfectly understandably, kind of put down their pens and said they're not going to be drawing Muhammad any longer. And, you know, for us, you know, although we were proud of that moment, you know, it was also an intense controversy of the kind that you can only live through every once in a while. So, you know, what I see is that I think a combination of religious sensitivities and now national security considerations are conspiring to shrink the zone of permissible speech and even the zone that free speech advocates are willing to comfortably defend. And I think Jacob did a really nice job laying out how that's crystallizing at this moment in Europe, where you have violence and terror fueling a mass migration of Muslim refugees, their presence in turn stoking fear of terror, fear that in itself fuels the marginalization and ostracization that are identified as drivers of violence and terror. And, you know, one of the few ways I think governments can see to put the brakes on that, unfortunately, is through speech, controls on speech. There's a lot about that cycle that they can't control, and free speech they've sort of grabbed onto is one of the things that they can. And I think Jacob's examples really convey the picture, so I'll skip a few of mine. But you know, one of the things that's most striking is this kind of 180 on the European position on defamation of religion, such staunch, and some of you here at this conference, I know because of my own work on fighting back against resolutions on the defamation of religion and a treaty, an attempt at an international treaty to ban defamation at the United Nations. And the Europeans were always the most staunch opponents of bans on the defamation of religion. And yet we now see, you know, all manner of extensions of their own law and policy on hate speech and anti-religious speech. In October, a judge in Germany sentenced a man to 5 months probation and a 300-euro fine for a Facebook post saying refugees should burn alive or drown in the Mediterranean Sea. You know, and there are just legions of examples of this. And, you know, at the UN, when we fought back against this, one of the points we made was that bans on speech wouldn't work, that there were other kinds of proven tactics to address hate speech, education, interfaith dialogue, the transparent and reliable prosecution of hate crimes. And I think the sense is almost those things take too much time and too much cultural change, and they're just too difficult and too slow moving to be the answer. And that bans and prosecutions of speech are sort of easier and more visible and immediate. And you know, the other piece I would add is that, at least in Germany, they're going after not just the individuals who post things like some of the social media posts that Jacob highlighted, but also the platforms that host that content. And they've extracted promises now from Google, Facebook, and Twitter in December, saying that they would work to delete anti-migrant sentiments voiced on their networks within 24 hours of the request, which is a level of control over ideas and viewpoints that goes far beyond what those companies' own content policies otherwise would allow. So a few just kind of quick summary observations on this. The first goes back to where I started with the rising cost of defending ugly speech. And it's just become difficult to be on the wrong or the politically incorrect side of this in an era of social media and instantaneous transmission and the loss of nuance and context. Standing up for controversial and offensive speech exposes you to a level of intense opposition that can leave a lasting and indelible online footprint. So the incentive just isn't there to defend that borderline speech. It becomes kind of thankless. I think one of the questions for us as advocates is how we can do this more in coalition so that we don't have to stand alone in defense and we're not mistaken for embracing these often odious ideas that we are duty bound as advocates to defend. I think the other piece is the subjectivity of speech and the fact that the same speech can mean very different things to different people, not even across borders, but you know, on the same college campus. We have these examples we've been talking about at the margins here of these chalkings, people writing Trump 2016 in chalk on the sidewalk on a college campus, and some students saying that alone makes them feel unsafe. And I could see, you know, people sort of, you know, laugh at that, and it seems kind of unimaginable that people even entertain the idea that such speech should be excluded. But I think we also have to acknowledge that the subjective experience of this speech, kind of like it or not, is very different depending on what group you're in. And if we sort of ignore that and override that and dismiss that, I think we're going to lose these arguments. So I think we need to do more to understand where that comes from and figure out how our law is going to deal with it. There's also what I see as sort of a counter-extremism catch-22, where the free speech advocates are so dissatisfied with every single tactic that governments are proposing that there's almost no room for conversation. People don't like the idea of taking down and censoring speech for obvious reasons. Counter-speech is also unpalatable. Government-sponsored counter-speech seems sinister. We don't like monitoring of social media feeds because that's going to disproportionately target certain communities. People talk about the algorithms that dictate that when someone searches for content about ISIS, kind of all they see is content about ISIS, and yet the idea of social media companies manipulating those algorithms to yield a different outcome is also seen as kind of highly problematic and intrusive and an overreach. You know, working with communities to ferret out extremism, you know, that too sort of has this aura of spying and intrusiveness. And so, you know, the concern I have is that if we reject even dialogue about all of those options, governments will choose their options on their own without a genuine dialogue with civil society, which they'll kind of write off as dismissing everything they do as unacceptable. And then the final point I'll make is about what I see as a kind of, you know, almost invisible voluntary convergence between governments and social media platforms on these issues. I mean, I think there's a reason why those platforms agreed to do that so quickly, which is that they don't want, just as governments don't want them to be vehicles for spreading counterterrorist ideology, nor do the companies want to be complicit in that. It's bad publicity. It drives people away. It causes parents to have concern about what time on Facebook or Twitter may do to the ideologies of their children. And so there's this convergence of interest between governments and platforms. I think we really don't know what the product of that is and the ways in which, you know, we know some things that governments are that companies are doing when they choose to announce it, but we also know there's a whole layer of collaboration. It's only because Apple and the FBI couldn't come to agreement that Tim Cook went public. But what is happening when they do come to agreement, we don't really know. So I think this combination of greater cultural sensitivity and fears of terrorism, as legitimate as they are conspiring to narrow the field for freedom of speech.
Statement?
Yep, please. Great. Well, let me, I think, join everybody in saying what a pleasure and an honor it is to be here. I spend far too much of my time inside the DC Beltway, both literally and figuratively. The people in Washington have a tendency to not think that there's a world outside the Beltway, just like my parents, who are old-school New Yorkers, think that upstate starts at 96th Street. I see it as my task on this panel to say a bit about developments in U.S. law when it comes to the intersection between religion, national security, and freedom of expression in 2015, and then make a couple of projections for 2016. And just to sort of spoil the punchline, I actually think the formal developments in the law in 2015 were actually relatively good, and that so far 2016 is looking potentially quite disastrous. So on that uplifting opening. There were two, I think, especially prominent judicial rulings in the United States last year with regard to the intersection between religion and national security, and they were both from federal appeals courts. So the first came in June from the federal appeals court here in New York, in a case called Turkman versus Hasty. And this was a long-standing, long-running civil suit challenging the FBI's roundup of immigrants of, quote, Arab or Muslim, unquote, descent in the weeks and months after the September 11th attacks. Things move slowly around here. And basically, the litigation was a challenge to both the reliance upon Arab and Muslim descent as a descriptor for suspicion, but also much more specifically the conditions of confinement that these particular plaintiffs faced once they were rounded up and once they were held in various forms of immigration detention. And the basic claim was that they were subjected to harsher conditions of confinement, not because of any individualized assessment of their risk, but because of their background, because of their religious and or national background. And in June, the divided panel, a 2-1 panel of the Second Circuit, basically ruled for the plaintiffs. What the court held was that the plaintiffs had stated a viable cause of action, that their claims, if true, were ones that were so clearly unconstitutional at the time that the facts arose, that the defendant officers, which included former Attorney General Ashcroft, former FBI Director Mueller, former INS Commissioner Ziegler, did not have immunity. Going off the facts as alleged in the complaint, the plaintiffs were entitled to complete relief. I should say, for those of you who haven't carefully studied post-9/11 civil litigation in the U.S., this was an astounding victory, and one that led the dissenting judge, Judge Rina Raji, to complain that it was the first time a federal appeals court had actually ruled for plaintiffs on facts like those in a post-9/11 counterterrorism case. And that was, I think, widely celebrated as a very big deal, although I'll talk about why the celebrations may have been somewhat premature. The second big ruling came a couple months later in October from the federal appeals court in Philadelphia in a case called Hassan versus City of New York, which Agnes mentioned very briefly this morning. In the Hassan case, a number of plaintiffs challenged the NYPD's post-September 11th demographics unit policy of conducting various forms of surveillance on Muslim neighborhoods in New Jersey on the ground that the NYPD did not have any defensible basis for singling out Muslim neighborhoods, that the various types of treatment and surveillance were discriminatory, that they violated the First Amendment rights of Muslim residents in these neighborhoods, that they violated the equal protection anti-discrimination rights, and so on and so forth. The district court in New Jersey had thrown out the suit on the ground that the only reason why the plaintiffs were injured was because of the Associated Press, which had reported on this secret program. And so if they had a complaint, it was against the Associated Press and not the NYPD. That was reversed rather cursorily by the Third Circuit. Far more significantly, the Federal Appeals Court in Philadelphia held that on the merits, the plaintiffs had stated a viable claim for relief. It was very preliminary, but that basically, if those allegations turn out to be true, those were sufficiently substantial claims that they should go forward. And that case actually went back to the trial court, where earlier this year, the city of New York filed its answer. So we're heading to more litigation in the lower courts. What's especially remarkable about the Hassan case is not just the result or the unanimous vote of the panel, but the reasoning and the rhetoric of the opinion is actually, I think, quite progressive in its effort to separate out paranoia and fear from rational bases for law enforcement investigations. There's a lot of effort by the majority of the judges to explain why we should have learned our lessons as Americans from some of the more insidious moments of prior discrimination, the Korematsu case from World War II, and so on. So those were two, I think, fairly positive developments, and they come really radically against this overwhelming pattern of disfavoring civil accountability for U.S. counterterrorism policies. So if you ever study the nerdy details of federal courts doctrine in the United States, it has become just about impossible in the years since September 11th for victims of counterterrorism abuses of any stripe to recover damages, to recover retrospective relief for even the most clearly established legal violations. If nothing else, these two decisions seem to be perhaps a hopeful step in the right direction, not just for claims of religious discrimination, but for far more general claims of government abuse in the national security sphere. Now, I said that this was all sort of looking backwards, it looked good. The downside is that the federal government sought rehearing before the Federal Appeals Court in New York. The Federal Appeals Court divided 6-6 on whether they should rehear the case. And the government has now received two extensions from the Supreme Court of its application for review there. It stands to reason that the government will file what's called a petition for certiorari in the Supreme Court. And you know, just to be a little pessimistic, the government has taken 5 national security cases to the Supreme Court since September 11th, and it's won all 5 of them. So we may not have heard the last word on the Turkmen case. We'll see. Okay. Now, if you want one sort of silver lining, that was when Justice Scalia was still on the court. With 8 justices, it's not as obvious that the government has 5 votes, but something to stay tuned for. The government's petition is now due the first week of May, so it'll be something to keep an eye out for in this field. But let me say, sort of as I was thinking about this panel and planning for today's conversation, it occurred to me that looking at litigation and jurisprudence in the U.S., I think largely misses the ball for where there's the most important intersection between religion and national security these days, that if you really want to see it, you need to look at the Republican campaign trail. Not because we all have favorite or least favorite candidates, but because the current 2 leading candidates for the Republican presidential nomination have both made at least what are, in my view, rather alarming public statements about using national security as a pretense for rather alarming religious-based discrimination. So for example, Donald Trump has proposed a categorical ban on all Muslim immigration into the United States. And even Senator Cruz, who I think is increasingly being portrayed as the less crazy Republican candidate for president, said just 2 weeks ago in the aftermath of the Brussels attacks that he would favor increased policing of, quote, Muslim neighborhoods, unquote. I think either of these individuals, if elected, I think would probably pursue some variant of that agenda. And so we'd have, if nothing else, an uptick in more litigation challenging religious-based discrimination in the context of U.S. national security law and policy. And let me say for Senator Cruz, this is nothing new. Senator Cruz actually proposed a couple years ago a bill that did not get a lot of attention called the Terrorist Expatriation Act, which would have allowed the Secretary of State, with very little judicial review, to simply point her finger at someone, call them a terrorist, and have that person not just deported, but first stripped of their citizenship, and then deported to apparently some other country with which that person had no prior connection since they were a US citizen. So we'd violate the statelessness convention as well. So I say all of this just to say that although the plaintiffs in the Turkmen case may eke out a narrow win because there are not currently five votes on the Supreme Court to rule for the federal government. I think the real question going forward for the intersection between national security and religion in the United States is who wins on November 8th. And I think those are going to be radically different approaches to how we handle this question in the aftermath of attacks like Brussels based on what happens then. So as we like to say, stay tuned.
Thank you. Thank you, Steve. Chinmayi?
Thank you. Can you hear me clearly? You can't? Okay. I think this should make it better. Okay, so I might zigzag a little bit across time, space, and doctrine, but I'm telling myself that it's very difficult to confuse a room full of lawyers. If I succeed, please ask me during questions. So broadly, what I'm building towards is this this argument that the hate speech challenge in India is contradictory in some ways, in the sense that we're simultaneously trying to solve the problem of what to do about hate speech that targets religious minorities and results in violence against them, while also trying to figure out what to do with hate speech law that is broadly worded and that affects a lot of legitimate speech. I think that this is reflected in different forms across the world. For us, it's sort of little starker, I'd say, because we have petitions before the Supreme Court asking for both. Sometimes you have a single petition asking for both things. So I feel like we're a little confused about it, and that's why projects like the Columbia Global Freedom of Expression Project, they're so useful in helping us sort of drill down to the details. I think that this case study may be useful because it's also a way to see how the currents of the world's speech norms touch countries like India. And so what I'm going to describe to you is actually ways in which norms across the world have influenced our jurisprudence both in the past and in the present. So foundationally, for example, a lot of our hate speech law, you know, law that criminalizes insulting religion, comes from the British. And so a lot of the action taken against that, under that law and under sedition law, is action that we quite happily blame on the British. But as I will, yes, always, you're welcome. If it's awful, well, Macaulay and his penal code is where it came from. But honestly, I mean, the Indians have contributed equally to the development of hate speech jurisprudence, and I'll describe how. So parts of hate speech law emerged in knee-jerk reaction to religious violence. So for example, insult to religion, which is used very frequently to arrest people in the context of offending religion, sometimes in, I would say, like Wendy Doniger sort of ways. This law was put in place as a knee-jerk reaction to a particular pamphlet that was actually satirical. But it may not have survived if the Indians hadn't amended their constitutions to sort of helpfully protect the law. So basically, our First Amendment added to the national... Originally, our free speech norm had a national security exception, and the Supreme Court refused to read... law and order into national security. And so what happened was that our very first government amended the constitution and added a public order exception to Article 19. And that public order exception is what ends up protecting quite a lot of the hate speech law that I'm going to discuss right now. So in the context of, before I go into the hate speech law itself, the other things that I'd like to contextualize in terms of international discourse is that later on, what's happened is that with the coming of the internet and with the increase of use of American jurisprudence in India, we've started talking quite a lot in terms of the First Amendment and in terms of the ICCPR, but from a very First Amendment point of view. And so you'll see a lot of people that are criticizing the criminalization of hate speech in India right now, arguing that it is completely against international norms and that hate speech needs to be decriminalized completely. Now, the trouble with that is that although the U.S. has a reservation against Article 4 of the Convention on Elimination of Racial Discrimination, India doesn't. So we are subject to Article 4, and we are required to criminalize certain kinds of hate speech. So there's some amount of trouble in the discourse itself, which is why I was, again, very happy to see Anias's papers, which actually acknowledge that there is this tension. We have a case pending currently before the Supreme Court in which there are politicians that are asking for decriminalizing of hate speech and that have challenged several of the penal code provisions that result in criminalization of hate speech. Simultaneously, we have had an NGO that approached the Supreme Court in response to violence caused by religion-based hate speech. And these people have asked that the Law Commission come up with law that strengthens the state's capacity to attack hate speech. And so what we started doing is one of the projects that my research center is working on right now is just going through the details of all of Indian law and of jurisprudence attached to Indian law to understand what the hate speech standards in India are right now. And to see whether there are any gaps. And what we're running into is actually, I would imagine, quite predictable for most of the people in this room, which is that the law on the books has stayed the same for several years. And what is interesting to observe is actually the way in which legal institutions are applying the law. So for example, we have had prominent politicians calling for violence against particular religious communities in public view while campaigning for elections. And when they've been arrested, institutional failure happens because 80 witnesses recant their statements and they're able to find labs that say that the videos of the statement are not authentic. At the same time, you have people that write books that are seen to be offensive, and you have mobs saying that they're going to riot, and that basically law is used to arrest them saying that, well, these people are causing a public order problem. And so it's okay to use the penal code to arrest these people. And so I guess that what is necessary to summarize is, going back to what Anya said earlier, is that we have the rubber plan of action. We have people repeatedly coming up with different factors that we can use to identify where speech is threatening and where it is not. But interestingly, this is not finding its way into actual jurisprudence. And perhaps it's useful to think of projects like the Columbia Project and the Freedom on the Net report as sort of audits. This is the way in which I treat them when I'm doing them, is that you're looking at jurisprudence and you're looking to see how state action is changing and how sort of states are choosing to read law on the books. I know that I'm running out of time, so I'm going to conclude with an example which illustrates my other point, which is that with the coming of the internet, I think that there's also a greater focus on gatekeepers. Previously, what we were discussing is criminalization, the direct, the interaction between the state and the individual, but now it's getting a little more confusing for judiciaries because states are tending to shut down the internet or to block communication in response to speech attacking religion. And this is where this law on the books and state action has become so interesting to me, is that for several years, India had internet shutdowns roughly once or twice a year, mainly in Kashmir, where they feared religious incidents or in response to great streaks of violence. But between August and October last year, we had 6 internet shutdowns, of which at least 4 were in the state of Gujarat, 1 was in the state of Rajasthan, both of which are mainland India and not really anything resembling a war zone, and 1 was in Manipur. After that, we've had more shutdowns. So what's happening is that there's some amount of state impunity in shutting down communication completely. And they do it under this criminal procedure code section, which is very broadly worded. It's basically anything that causes a public order problem that might cause annoyance to certain individuals. Very, very broadly worded provision allowing for executive action at the state level. It's getting so ridiculous that a couple of months back, the state of Gujarat shut down the internet because there was an exam going on and they thought that the copying would cause a public order problem. Now, this brings me back to my attention of, it's also a year in which we have had Muslim people being lynched because there were rumors that they were storing beef in their fridges. And that lynching happened within weeks of shutting down of the internet in Gujarat to prevent violence against people of a certain caste. And so what's interesting over here is that state action is resulting in the repression of speech, but not necessarily in the prevention of violence. And I think that what's going to be challenging for us is not only to examine law and to see how the state can be limited in the way in which it uses law, but also ask ourselves whether there are things that we can do outside of the law using
the Rabat plan of action using questions like questions that this panel has highlighted before. So for example, if there are schools in, and there are schools in India indoctrinating people to religious hatred, are there solutions to this that are not necessarily state action and that are not necessarily embedded in the law?
Thank you very much. We have 20 minutes for questions, or yeah, 20 minutes. I just want to revisit a few of the themes that I brought up and then ask maybe two open-ended questions, and I'll let whoever wants to answer, and then we'll open it up. So the first is, it was very clear that context matters, power matters, and freedom is subjective. I heard these themes throughout. And I'm curious to know what my co-panelists think with regard to differentiating, whether it's from a normative perspective or, more importantly, as a lawyer, from a legal perspective, speech that targets government action versus speech that targets private citizens. Second is speech that targets powerful groups versus speech that targets powerless groups. Now, of course, we'll start arguing about how do you define powerful versus powerless, but to what extent do you all think there should be a differentiation as a matter of law, and if not, how can we address the realistic differences in terms of, it's one thing to engage in quote-unquote hate speech, for lack of a better term, against a very wealthy white male Protestant in America who is a member of a political who's like the head of a political party, right? So if you're a member of a very powerful group, it's like water off a duck's back. But if you're a member of a minority group that may not have the wealth to go to court, may not have the sophistication or access to lawyers, may not have access to the media, may already be dealing with stereotypes, should that be treated the same? I don't know. I mean, arguably the law says yes. And then the other is, what if it's targeting the government? So you are, in fact, actively dissenting against government action as opposed to targeting individual private citizens who, for hypothetical purposes, are not would not qualify as public figures. So do you all have any thoughts on those differentiations, or do you think they're completely meaningless and shouldn't be considered from either a legal, policy, or normative perspective?
So take the Danish cartoon case, with which I'm very familiar. One of the arguments has been here, what you're doing here is you're mocking a vulnerable minority in Denmark. Okay, you can argue that. What happens? Danish Muslims go to Egypt, Saudi Arabia, and suddenly you have Muslim majority countries instituting different kinds of measures of pressure against Denmark, and you have editors in Jordan, Muslim majority country, being jailed for the same cartoons. And also, if you're not allowed, when it comes to Islam, if you're not allowed to criticize Islam in the West, then where can you criticize Islam? I mean, it's not so easy in many of the OIC countries, for instance, to criticize Islam. And that does not just pertain to non-Muslims. It pertains, as we've seen in Bahrain and many other places. I mean, if you're a Shia Muslim in Saudi Arabia, are you going to be able to criticize Saudi Arabia? No. If you're a Sunni in Iran, are you going to be able to freely criticize Islam there? No. And I would also, if I was a Muslim group in Europe, I would be a free speech fundamentalist. I would be arguing for First Amendment protection, because what we're seeing now is all, principle is being removed. And what happens then when Geert Wilders and Marine Le Pen come into power? Their arguments are a bit like, Geert Wilders says, okay, I want to ban the Quran because there's hateful things in the Quran. I want to close down a mosque, etc. And, once you take away the principle, then if you have a new majority in power, then the laws against hatred and offense, only become, they are only a political majority away from rather than benefiting a group, you become the target of it. So I think you're playing an extremely dangerous game, especially in the current political climate. I mean, we're not far away from European countries having far-right leaders. and they're not going to be very sensitive to international human rights norms. So even if the European Court of Human Rights says, well, you know, hate speech limits are okay here, but not here, as they've done in some cases, is Geert Wilders or Marine Le Pen, are they going to be impressed and swayed by Strasbourg court on this? No, it just plays into their hands. These are international elites with their international human rights norms. And look, you know, we were imprisoned, we were targeted by these hate speech laws, and now they want to say that this is protected by freedom of expression. So of course you can context means a lot, but I think it's a very dangerous game to play when it's in the legal sphere.
Okay. I just want to briefly agree with that and just say, I mean, I think from a U.S. perspective, putting aside First Amendment doctrine, which is a disastrous mess and is just not worth trying to make sense of it here. I get very nervous about suggesting that the law creates categories of distinction when it comes to speech, because then someone has to enforce those lines. And so the analogy I like to use is in the context of Potter Stewart's famous speech about the freedom of the press. You know, if we actually had a meaningful press clause in the First Amendment as opposed to just speech clause, that would require someone to explain who is the press and who isn't. And it would require someone to create criteria by which one becomes a member of this protected class. And I think, you know, that is as dangerous to the notion of free expression as the principle that is purportedly being invoked to help protect.
Steve, did you want to
add? Yeah, look, one of the things I think we always need to think about when we're looking at law or any situation within society is the underlying social conditions under which it arises. So if we look at a number of the political parties rising in Europe, Le Pen, for example, or if we go to Holland as well, what they're doing is they're latching on to something which they can actually gain political power from. So it's really sort of coming down to the topic of the day, if you like. If we extract back and we look at the development or the social development, let's say, in Europe, but more importantly in the US, there's a concept called, let's say, positive peace. They're the attitudes, institutions, and structures which create and sustain peaceful societies. So I'll just use the US as an example. So if we look at this, one of the five worst deteriorations in the last 15 years is the US in these measures. It's pretty surprising. We go to Europe at the moment and we look at the debt which Europe's soaking under, the high levels of unemployment. You've got this underlying anger which is coming through. And the anger we can see in the US, we can see candidates like Donald Trump being able to now harness that to some political end. And similarly, that's what you're seeing in Europe as well. So we start to extract back from just the topic of the day and start to look at the underlying social conditions and look at trying to address them in the long run. That's what will create tolerance.
Do you want to add something to this?
I mean, I think that my solution to this discomfort between embedding norms that differentiate between the powerful and the powerless and basically create sort of subjective standards, I would say that I'd at least like to start looking at data. So given that there are all these institutions doing audits of how speech law is being implemented, what would be great is to start seeing how they're being implemented, because my feeling is that we're going to start seeing this consistent story coming up. And I feel like that might be a good starting point, even if we can't think of an institutional implementation. I think that what I'm hearing from what everyone is saying today is that there is clearly a problem between the ways in which these laws, the ways in which speech is used against the powerful versus the powerless. When speech is, I think speech against the government is, that to my, I'm like a total fundamentalist about that. I think you should be allowed to criticize the government as much as you want. But I think that that should also apply to a great degree to the powerful. But I take everybody's point that drawing those lines is difficult. One of the things about teaching in a law school is that when you go and do this, your students immediately raise their hands and say, well, what category would you come up with for that? And, you know, maybe the solution is an audit. Let's at least examine how our systems are going wrong.
Okay. Well, thank you. Thank you. So I'll open it up, and I will just say that if you speak for more than 40 seconds, I'm going to cut you off because it's limited to questions. Yes.
Can you hear me all right? I guess my question is, what say you, particularly Suzanne, I had followed the Charlie Hebdo mess, and of course I was quite vocal regarding Trudeau and all. Bottom line is, we kept using this word hate speech. What say you, panel or anybody, that this is meaningless, and that what you're really doing is punishing the motive force. It's thought crime that you're after. You're punishing or trying to cure hate. It's not hate. There's no such thing as hate speech. It's the hate that you're trying to get at, which you're addressing social conditions and policies and all this going to. But what say you to the notion that there really is no such thing as hate speech? It's like saying hate shoes or hate soap. What say you?
A little bit to follow up on Suzanne's question, but picking up on Steve's point about social conditions, why should countering terrorism be so obsessing with speech? I think this is a very legitimate question that has gotten very little answers. Anytime the FBI, the CIA, the French Prime Minister, or whoever takes the floor to talk about countering terrorism, within the first three points, speech or internet is going to be spoken of, and is going to be. And to me, my impression, having now tried to follow the field for about a year and a half, 2 years, is that the people in charge of countering terrorism have kind of forgotten the basics of policing, including infiltration, including building trust with the communities, and are completely obsessing over mass surveillance, internet surveillance as a primary force through which we're going to find the next terror attack. Now, it may happen, but because we are not purview to all the findings, it's impossible to actually know that. There was only one case that I know of where there was a direct link between prevention of a terror attack and surveillance, nothing else. So I think this is a question that we ought to ask, we here. And then the second point, I want to reiterate what I've said this morning. In this country, 34 people were convicted on speech-related offenses. Nobody here talks about them. They are the poorest of the poor, the most disenfranchised, the latest migrants. They all have funny-sounding names, most of them. And they are all convicted on material support charges. That, to me, is really the cutting edge for whoever wants to defend free speech in this country. But nobody's going to look at their case. There was only one or two cases where those guys have been tried. Everyone else, they've just been, what is the term? There was no trial because they said they were guilty to begin with.
Well, why don't, well, those sounds like three questions, so let's take those.
I can start. Go ahead. I agree with you, Charles. I think the notion of hate speech really is problematic, and there are some efforts right now to kind of redraw the line. There's a project run by Susan Benish. It's called the Dangerous Speech Project, and she's sort of trying to draw ring fence, like a smaller subset of speech that is incitement to imminent violence or threatening that she thinks can be legitimately regulated, but implicitly to say that the rest of hate speech can't be or shouldn't be. And I think it's true. I think this term has become very malleable, and it gets conflated with things like cyber stalking that really are crimes. And I think we've become very loose when talking about hate speech, especially in a global context, because it means very different things. So I think we should be leery about panel titles, paper titles, and any other reference to hate speech. To Agnes, you know, I think just two comments. I mean, one is there's this sort of assumption of a causal link between radical speech and violent radical acts. And I think, you know, Fleming Rose makes this point that that causal connection has really never been proven, and you know, moreover, it also hasn't been proven that even if you sort of stanch the speech, that you thwart the act or the impulse to act. So I think that's an important point to bring home. But I think what you're up against is, you know, if you look at the spectrum of tools that law enforcement and governments have to counter terrorism, you can understand why they go for restrictions on speech, because everything else is more expensive, higher risk, kind of harder control. These are levers that sit in their hands, and they need to be seen to be doing something. And this is a relatively easy way, you know, in my view, that they can be seen to act concretely. And so that's, I think, the temptation of it and what we're up against.
I have a more cynical response on yes, which is I actually think part of it is bureaucratic politics. And what I mean by that is, if you look at which U.S. government agencies are responsible for which pieces of our counterterrorism agenda, all of the sort of nation building, you know, state building, sort of on the, you know, grassroots, what you might call the happy crunchy stuff, is the State Department, right? And all of the sort of nasty coercive stuff is DOJ, DOD, and the intelligence community. No, and I think, and I don't, I mean, I'm oversimplifying, but not by that much. And I think the problem is that, you know, the sort of the bureaucratic competition, I think, creates these weird incentives where counterterrorism policy does not become this sort of top-down operation, but rather this bottom-up operation where you have different agencies with different inputs into what we're doing. And so I think, you know, the noise of the more coercive stuff, both from a sort of public attention and from an internal dynamic perspective, drowns out, I think, the potentially more positive, right, the more speech-friendly of these operations. But, I get the problem is you're assuming that there's policy being made from the top down, and I think the problem is that that's not how things are working in Washington these days. And on the material support point, I mean, I think it's just worth stressing, you know, I think probably the worst U.S. legal decision for freedom of expression since 9/11 was the Supreme Court's 2010 decision in the Humanitarian Law Project case. Not just because it upheld the material support statute, but the way it upheld the material support statute makes it so easy for prosecutors to hide all kinds of what to me are nefarious illicit motives behind completely benign prosecutions for a super simplistic offense. And so I think, you know, 37 people can look at 37 material support prosecutions and see 47 different motives. And I think that's just the nature of the beast.
Did you want to add something? Go ahead.
Yeah. Hate speech. Excellent. That was just an excellent way of putting them together. I think a lot of ways, really, resilience. So if you've got a society which is resilient and people are resilient, you can say, idiots can say as much hate as they like, and other people will just dismiss it. It's just when the underlying social conditions are such that people attach to it. So what we really should have is a society where we can say anything, we can be as bizarre as we like and as unconventional as we like, and other people are resilient to our idiosyncrasies. I think Agnes's point was excellent. I don't think there's really a clear answer to it at this stage, but it's something which I think really we all should think, consider, we should think about deeply. I was in The Hague last week. I'm a little bit jet-lagged at the moment. And I was with the leading politician there, and we were talking about sort of a number of different issues on global peace. And she said to me, she said, look, as a politician, the only facts we're interested in, which is something to support our case. The rest you discard. Now, if we look at the media, a lot of talk in here about free media, but there isn't such anything as a free media. The media, other than maybe the BBC or the CBS here, it's got two guiding principles. The first is the number of eyeballs which look at their publications. And the second is the advertising revenue which they raise from that. So as you're starting to look at the way news is delivered, it's delivered on those two paradigms. So thinking we've got a free speech in America or Australia or Europe, it's a little bit naive. Now, politicians, okay? We come back to the statement before. The first thing a politician wants to do is have their face or their quotes on the front page of the paper. Now, being able to draw a direct connection with a one-liner, which will now get that coverage and can be picked up by a media which is interested in rankings and ratings, I think that's the driving force. Now, how do you bring all that together? I don't know. But on the other hand, short-termism in politics reigns supreme. Announcing more money on security is a really easy way to get a headline. Now, talking about social inequalities, being able to address unpayable debts, because that's what most of the countries in the West have got at the moment, including America. You may not see it, but it's growing all the time. Or employment. These are very, very difficult issues to grasp with. But by hitting security, you've got a short-term, real quick win.
Thank you. And I'll take two more questions, but I do want to respond to your hate speech point.
Thank you.
It's hateful speech that, in my opinion, is correlated to hate crimes and discrimination. That's where my root of concern is. What I do is I work with Muslim communities in dealing with the fallout from the hateful speech that is not illegal, and nor do they actually want it to be illegal. These communities are not calling for that. They, in fact, agree with you, Jacob, and as a religious minority, they are quite fundamentalist on their free speech rights or free expression, because they understand that as a member of a minority, it could flip on them. The problem they're facing is they're experiencing second-class citizenship de facto experiences, where in their lives they are having to deal with the fallout of all of these indulgences by people who have power to be very hateful, and there isn't enough response to that speech, and they don't have access. There are so many condemnations of terrorism, and so many people speaking on behalf of the majority of Muslims and trying to challenge what they think is very hateful things about Islam and Muslims, but you all don't read it. You don't see it, because I guess it doesn't get enough eyeballs, it doesn't bleed, and they're facing very real harms to their daily lives. And so I am not arguing for a quashing of free speech. I study dictatorships in the Middle East, and I get it. The problem is, how do we grant them equal citizenship in their real experiences, and how do we have as much passion for defending hateful speech as we do about the civil rights of those who then deal with the baggage? So, and I don't have any answers. I just want everyone here to be as concerned with that, because they're not disconnected if you live in that particular community. And I would argue that if you were Jewish American and you were dealing with anti-Semitism in Germany or even now, you might share that belief without necessarily saying we don't want free speech rights. Just have it in the same conversation. I'm sorry, so we have time for two more questions and then we'll end. Yes.
Thank you. If I may take the liberty of a surrebuttal to that. There was some research undertaken by the Programme in Comparative Media Law and Social Policy at Oxford. Many people in the room know the programme, and they worked with GCHQ to monitor speech and looked for hate speech as an indicia to conflict. And they found very little correlation between hate speech and conflict, and it might well be worth you reading that paper, because I think it's, as far as I'm aware, the only empirical work on it. I do think it needs to be redone in the light of the religious changes that we've seen more recently. I wanted to pick up on Steve's point on social development. And I think, interestingly, we all know that we can't say fire in a crowded theatre because it's dangerous speech. We know that Radio Mille Collines was effectively inciting to violence, so it was another form of dangerous speech. But what we've got with Steve's point is, I think, something that I've only ever heard from Lee Kuan Yew, which is slightly worrying, I think, which is about this issue around social development. And he says, well, of course, we have to restrict speech in Singapore because we're not as socially developed as the rest of the world. And I think, you know, you can pick places, whether it's India or Pakistan or wherever you choose, and say, well, of course, if you say things that are rude about particular religious, then you will get violence as a consequence. Just that's the way it happens in that society. So the question is, how do you deal with that in the light of a universality of standard or a theory of universality of standard?
Let's take one more question.
Yeah, to make a connection with the previous panel on emerging norms, quick question. Are we seeing the emergence of a new right, which is the right not to be offended, as emerged in campuses and so on? And the second thing connected to what you were saying regarding powerful and non-powerful, there was a very interesting study regarding the evolution of blasphemy laws in Pakistan from the British rule that was a uniform protection of all religions to the post-1976, I think, legislation, which is now the protection of one particular religion. So it switched from protection of minorities to a protection of majority, actually.
Yeah, I mean, on the right not to be offended, I mean, the thing that's interesting is it's not entirely new. I mean, here in the United States, we really do accept that right exists, for example, in the workplace, you know, and we have all kinds of civil rights protections that dictate what can and can't be said or displayed in a workplace, and the idea is really to make everybody comfortable and kind of to make it safe. I mean, we've never thought about it that way necessarily, and I think the debate now is, well, where else should it be safe? You know, should it be safe on a college campus, in a college dorm? Should it be safe online? And I think, you know, we're groping for answers to that. I think the instinct is, well, not as safe as the workplace, but not entirely unsafe, not so unsafe that women feel like they can't, you know, weigh in on a debate about abortion because they're at risk of having their address published and, you know, being facing threats to their life. So I think there's, you know, that right to be offended sort of does exist at some level today, and the question is, you know, where does it apply and to what degree? And, you know, on the discussion between Sahar and Mark, I think, you know, one point you sort of implicitly make is that there can be, even if this hate speech or whatever we maybe should call it, because that term has become so amorphous, and I think sort of does imply a legal connotation that somehow it should be regulated, even though a lot of people disagree with that. You know, it may not correlate with hate crime, but it can still cause real harm, even if it doesn't. And I think that's, you know, that's impossible to deny. And I think that's, you know, we've always sort of had the idea, going back to childhood, kind of sticks and stones may break my bones, but names can never hurt me. I just think that's not true anymore. And it's hard, you know, part of it's the internet and social media and a lot of factors. But I think we sort of have yet to really come to grips with that.
Yep, I'll just quickly finish up. So Singapore, like, fine, okay, it worked well for Singapore for where they are, where they were in the 60s as they come through, but Lee Kuan Yew now's gone, but his son is now the next part of the dynasty. Like, those kind of things, not what I was trying to get at when I was speaking earlier on. What I'm simply trying to say, that there's a whole lot of anger and frustration and disenchantment with the system, both in Europe and particularly here in the US. And that comes about because the failure of the system to address things like unemployment. So you've got failure of the system to be able to actually solve its debt issues and a whole range of other issues. So without fixing these underlying problems, that frustration boils up into anger, then spills over into the things which we see. And I'm all for free speech. In fact, I think there shouldn't be any impediments on it at all. That's my personal vision.
Just when it comes to the correlation, there was a very interesting study from Norway last year. It looked at right-wing violence, and it found that Sweden was the country in Western Europe that had the most killings by right-wing extremists in the last per capita in the last 25 years. And if you know Sweden, you'll know that the free speech is less free than, for instance, Norway and Denmark. So in 2014, an artist was sentenced to 6 months imprisonment for some racially offensive posters exhibited in an art gallery. The gallery owner was also convicted. And there's a much more filtering of on issues on immigration and Islam. And these two Norwegian social scientists argued that the restrictions on free speech, both legal and informal, was a likely contributing factor to right-wing extremist violence in Sweden. I think it's also interesting to look at the last theater of a European genocide, former Yugoslavia. In the former Yugoslavia, at the time of the breakup, you had a law where you could go to prison of up to 10 years if you engaged in hate speech against the other ethnic groups in Yugoslavia. So that also suggests that hate speech laws may not be efficient at cultivating tolerance. And I think one of the big problems, especially in Europe, is that we no longer conceive of tolerance as tolerance was supposed to be understood. You know, we now see tolerance as something that has to be enforced. Tolerance means you don't have the right to say something, when tolerance really means that you have to suffer those things with which you disagree the most. So I think we've gone back from the days of Spinoza, who in 1670 showed sort of Amsterdam as the enlightened place of Europe where people of all creeds could live together, where you had freedom of expression, because people could sort of basically have their religious freedom of expression. And today we've, to a certain degree, regressed from that, and we see tolerance as the need to shut other people up. And that, you know, it says so explicitly in Strasbourg cage law, and I think that's quite disconcerting.
Okay, we'll just have one final comment by Ms. Chinmayi, and then we'll close.
Thank you. I mean, it's great to hear that PCMLP has done an empirical study, but a single empirical study doesn't tell us anything more than in that context, the speech didn't contribute to violence. I feel like there's a need to do more empirical studies, and I hope that we can all encourage companies to share data with us so that we can check this, because honestly, detail is what is necessary in this context. Speaking to this whole...
Just to respond to that, it was done across a series of locations around the world, and it was monitored by GCHQ. So it was pretty thorough in the way in which it was undertaken.
I should take a
look. We'll take a look at it.
Yes. The hate speech question, I mean, I was discussing Charlie Hebdo with someone because it was very controversial in my country. Just liberals were sort of split down the middle in how they reacted. And the someone was, you know, free speech scholars. So his reaction was one that I loved, and so I'm just, you know, going to voice it, which is that he said that, you know, I wouldn't want it censored because all kinds of speech and criticisms need to exist in the world. But I also wouldn't want legal institutions to encourage it and to make it mainstream because of what it stands for the minorities. You know, and that line is really important, and that's where I'd like to conclude, because if we're thinking of this power versus powerless, I think that, you know, the hate speech category is important because dangerous speech is the category that we do get to censor. But everything else is speech that we want to respond to in some way, not necessarily censorship and not necessarily in a command-controlled manner.
And with that, please join me in thanking our panelists.